Jerusalem is not a promise that the Jewish people will be saturated with power. It's a promise that the world will have access to our values. And so in the end of days, not only can Torah apply, it must apply. Torah is a defining feature of the end of days. The end of days, our law, our Torah, is precisely what's going to inspire, uplift, and transform the world around us. That is the perspective on divine law according to the Torah. Now, let us contrast this for a moment with the perspective on divine law that emerges from the Greek source. Now, here again, although, of course, the Torah is the only truly infinite tradition to which we have access and which we can come to, but if we have to choose among humanly generated traditions, one that is deep and exhausting and take a long time to explore fully, I think the top candidate would be the Greco-Roman tradition. I mean, it's quite exhaustive. It is truly an astonishing and impressive feat, at least of human ingenuity, just from a pure technical perspective. But I think even here, I think you can offer a sort of broadly representative, even an impressionistic survey of Greek and Roman thought. What I'm going to offer you here are sort of two sources that I think, in this case, I'm on firmer ground, just from an historian's perspective. Here, I think Greek and Roman historians, really as a whole, would concur that this is, at least at this level of abstraction, is broadly representative of the Greco-Roman tradition of divine laws. Take a look at the sources I've given you. Okay. We just seen that for the Torah, divine law can be particular, non-rational, it can be applied differently to different times and places, it must be rooted in history and is ideal. Now, I give you now a source from Cicero. Who was Cicero? When did he live? Cicero lived at the turn of the eras. He was one of the great orators in history. He's one of the great lawyers in history. He was one of the primary political figures in Julius Caesar's Rome. So he's sort of one of the great thinkers at the end of the Roman Republic as it transitions into an empire under the rule of Julius Caesar and then later Augustus Caesar. So Cicero, of course, is looking at a time when he knows a great deal about Jews. Cicero, in some cases, appears to say nice things about Jews. In other cases, he says nasty things about Jews. It's all complicated stories. But Cicero certainly was a very penetrating and important political thinker. And here, although Cicero was a Roman, he was deeply influenced by what's called the Stoic tradition in Greek thought. And in general, Cicero was an ardent explorer of Greek political thought. And so here, Cicero sort of sums up what is, in essence, a distillation of everything that the Greeks and Romans thought about divine law. So here's what Cicero says. His true law is right reason in agreement with nature. Now, the word that Cicero here uses, or the phrase that Cicero uses here in Greek for true law is nomos alethes, which in Greek means true, and literally just means sort of the law of truth. But it is, nomos alethes is an identical term, and Cicero in fact uses the two completely interchangeably, and does so even later in the passage, with nomos theos. What does nomos theos mean? The law of God. So nomos means law, like for example, antinomian, somebody who is antinomian, who is antinomos, is someone who violates the law. And theos is the root of what word that we use frequently? Theology. So theos just means godly. So nomos alethes and nomos theos are interchangeable phrases. So when Cicero says true law, what he means here is the law of God. Okay. True law is right reason in agreement with nature. It is of universal application, unchanging, everlasting. It summons to duty by its commands and averts wrongdoing by its prohibitions. And there will not be different laws at Rome and at Athens, or different laws now and then in the future. But one eternal and unchangeable law will be valid all nations, all times. There will be one master and ruler, that is God, over us all. For he is the author of this law, its promulgator, and its enforcing judge. Whoever is disobedient is fleeing from himself and denying his human nature. And by reason of this very fact, he will suffer the worst penalties, even if he escapes what is commonly considered punishment. Okay. So Cicero, much like the Torah, says you have to keep the law because God gave you the law. However, when Cicero says divine law, what does he mean? So let's think about some of the things that Cicero used to identify law. What does Cicero think divine law means?
Nature.
Excellent. In fact, another term that Cicero uses interchangeably with nomos alethes, true law, and nomos theos, godly law, is nomos physis, which means natural law. But physis is sort of the Greek root of the word that we use physical, or physics, for example. So Cicero thinks that divine law, the true law, is completely identical and interchangeable with natural law, with the rules of nature. So in order for a law to be divine, it needs to be perfectly logical, perfectly accessible to human rationality. If it can't be reconstructed by human reason, it's not divine. It's not divine. What's another feature that Cicero picks up? Yes?
Unchanging.
Completely unchanging. And by unchanging, what specifically does he say?
And everlasting.
And everlasting meaning no matter where you live, if you live in Sparta or if you live in Athens, it's the same. If you live now, it's the same. If you live later, it's the same. If you live before Kinesa Laharetz, if you live before the entrance of the land of Israel, it is exactly the same than it is if you go into the land of Israel. No matter what, it has to be the same because it has to be natural, it has to be mathematical, it has to be reasonable, it has to be natural. So for Cicero, divine law and a law rather can only be divine if it is perfectly rational, perfectly reasonable, has nothing to do with your personal experience. I mean, how could any of us think that our experiences are so important that it can influence the law of God? I mean, it's hubris of the highest order from Cicero's perspective. So it can't have anything to do with our history, can't have anything to do with our story, it can't be different now and later, it can't even apply differently now and later. For Cicero, law is right. Perfect reason is natural law. Now, for the final question of will law apply in sort of an ideal future? So Cicero doesn't address this question, but Plato thought a great deal about the future and about how things would be in the end of days. So Plato actually did think about this question. Take a look at the next source. So Plato says, I grant you, rebel, that if ever by God's mercy a man were born, no laws to govern. No law or ordinance whatever has the right to sovereignty or true knowledge. Listen, as things are, such insight is nowhere to be met with except in vague vestiges, and so we have to choose the second best ordinance in law. So for Plato, is law ideal? Certainly not. Law is second best. Ideally, we wouldn't need it. We'd just be able to reason our way towards everything. But since, listen, never for humans, so we have to have laws. Okay. So again, contrast the two traditions. The Jewish tradition, the biblical tradition, the Torah sees law as able to be something. It can be in particular, it need to be amenable to human rationality, it can apply differently depending on time and space, it is rooted in our personal relationship with Hashem and our collective relationship with God, and it is ideal, and it guides the world. For the Greeks, although they said exactly what we say, which is that divine, which is that law is binding because it is divine, what they meant by that was something that is the polar opposite of our tradition, which is law is divine when it is reasonable, rational, completely unchanging, applies identically no matter where you are, has nothing to do with our personal story, and it is not ideal. Okay. Now, the fact that we have identified two traditions that, although they use the same vocabulary, are in radical diametrical opposition to each other would seem to be or need necessarily be a consequence. Although it is true that from a historical perspective, these sort of ideas were crystallizing at roughly the same time. So the Torah is thinking, of course, many hundreds and hundreds of years before the Greeks were thinking. But certainly Jewish people were putting all of these thoughts together and thinking about their implications well into the Second Temple period. The Baal Shem, of course, one of the greatest sort of sages and compilers of Torah in our history, as the Gemara identifies as who? Ezra Sofer, sort of the eponymous, the namesake of Sefer Ezra. And as Ezra and his compatriot, the governor Nehemiah, are touring Jerusalem's walls and exhorting their people to justice, at the very same time that that's happening in the 5th century, Socrates is wandering the streets of Athens, sort of intellectually bothering young men and being condemned to drink hemlock by the authorities of Athens. Exact same thought. However, never the twain shall meet. At least that was what people would have assumed for several centuries. Two had nothing to do with each other. Until, that is, the year 331 BC. What happened in the year 331 BC? In that year, a young man, younger than I am, in his 20s, amassed an enormous, but rather idiosyncratic, but certainly professional, well-professionally militarily trained following, sort of a backwater of the Greek world, Macedonia. He marched his armies across the entirety of Asia Minor, conquering far and wide, bringing people under his dominion as far to the east as India, as far to the west, as far to Europe, his health. He died. And he died shortly after he conquered the world. I mean, sort of really as is made famous in the movie Die Hard, you know, Alexander wept, for there were no worlds left to conquer. So after Alexander conquers the world, he sort of promptly expires. And then what happens is that his successors, his generals, Seleucid people like Seleucus and Seleucid Empire fame, Ptolemy and Ptolemaic Empire fame, so all of his generals who were sort of military geniuses with lesser personalities than Alexander was sort of unable to hold the empire together, notwithstanding their best efforts and their sort of power-hungry ambition. But they aren't able to hold the empire together, and so the thing splits apart. However, the great project that Alexander initiated in spreading his empire was a project called Hellenization. In fact, the very first appearance of the word, what is Hellenization mean, by the way? Let's define some terms.
It comes from Elas, like from Greece, Greek
excellent.
Greece, and
right.
Making things Greek.
The Roman one was Hellas, right? Yeah. Excellent.
Making things Greek.
Yes, so spreading Greek culture across the world. In other words, you didn't need to spread Greek culture in Greece, they were already Greek. But Hellenization, sort of taking the ideas and values and philosophy in Hellas, in Greece, and spreading it across the world, that was called Hellenization. The idea of sort of taking Greek culture and Islamizing it. Now, the very first appearance of the word Hellenization, was coined by whom? Does anyone know? By a Jewish people. It appears in the second book of Maccabees, which is one of the books that didn't make it into Tanakh, but it's a book that was written in the diaspora in Cyprus, and it's about the story of Hanukkah, and it's there that the word Hellenism appears for the first time in human history. So Hellenism is something that people who were not Hellenes themselves experienced. In other words, when the Greeks conquered them, all of a sudden they had to deal with a foreign culture. Now, as the Gemara tells us about Alexander, so in many ways the confrontation or the encounter between our culture and Alexander's culture was a salutary one, was a healthy one. In other ways it wasn't, but certainly there's what to talk about in that respect. However, one thing that became abundantly, immediately clear, as soon as the Jewish culture and the Greek culture encountered each other, was that when it came to thinking about law, and in particular, divine law, there was an irreconcilable tension in their ideas. And in fact, over the course of the next several hundred years, the greatest minds of both the Greek and the Jewish tradition would explicitly engage in a project of working through and working out of this tension. And I'd like to share with you